subject is the Antichrist, an alternative view. What we're going to explore is the possibility, at least, that there may be a very widespread myopia regarding the subject of the Antichrist that we too have fallen into. And so we're going to try to stand back from our presuppositions of the past and try to let the text speak to us. And if we're correct, we may come up with some real surprises. Quite a different perspective from the very commonly presumed scenario for the end times. So let's just start backwards a little bit. We all talk about Armageddon, that climactic battle at the end of the age, getting its name, of course, from Revelation 16:16. He gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon, which is Harmageddon or Mount Megiddo, if you will. And that's a literal place on the planet Earth. In fact, if you take the planet Earth and zero in to a particular piece of real estate called Israel, you'll discover there is a place that you can visit called Megiddo, overlooking a valley, the valley of Jezreel. On the opposite side of that valley is the city of Nazareth up on the hill. It's kind of interesting that from Megiddo you see Nazareth. When Jesus was being raised as a child, he would look across that valley and see Megiddo. And you wonder, you can't help but speculate, how much did he know as a child? Most scholars presume that he came into his full knowledge at his baptism, but who knows? But the Valley of Jezreel, there really isn't a battle of Armageddon, by the way. That's what we all speak of. Armageddon has a relationship to Jerusalem that England did to the Normandy invasion. In other words, it's the gathering place. But the target, of course, is Jerusalem. All of us have seen the little maps in prophecy books which talks about the sequence of the Battle of Armageddon, which is actually detailed in Daniel 11. It starts by a push by the kings of the south against a king of the north. And we usually see the European confederacy coming in, and everything's going swimmingly until the kings of the east are on the horizon. It's commonly envisioned as a four-power conflict. And setting aside for the moment who the kings of the south and kings of the north are, these are all idioms from Daniel chapter 11. The question is, where do we find this Western Confederacy in Daniel 11? If you look, you won't find it there. It's an inference we draw because we know from other passages that the Antichrist comes from the Roman Empire. And out of this come all kinds of conjectures that the Antichrist is a Western European-based leader, we're going to explore that. If you look at Daniel 11, we'll discover that there isn't a Western Confederacy as such. But let's step back all the way to the beginning. The earliest civilizations are generally recognized as having started in what we call the Fertile Crescent, Egypt, Assyria, and Babylonia, in a region that becomes central to most of history. A city in the Assyrian Empire called Babylon, ultimately under the leadership of Nebuchadnezzar, becomes an empire, it is succeeded by the Persians, and the Persians are succeeded by the Greeks, that brings us up almost to the Roman period. In fact, the leader that we're going to spend some time looking at is Alexander the Great, a young guy that at the age of 29 found no more worlds to conquer. In 11 years, he conquered most of the known world. When he dies, at his peak actually, his empire is divided among his four generals, Cassandra, Lysimachus, Seleucus, Ptolemy. Since Israel, the two powerful players are Seleucus and Ptolemy, and as rivals, they constantly engage over this buffer state called Israel. We often speak of the 400 silent years, those are the years between the Testaments, the Old Testament ending at the book of Malachi and the New Testament, of course, with the Gospels. The roughly 400 years between those are sometimes called the silent years. Well, that's overlooking the fact that much of that history during those four centuries is detailed in advance in Daniel chapter 11. So we're going to discover that Daniel 11 is a very key passage to really understand for many reasons. But obviously after the Greek Empire came the Roman Empire, most of us are familiar with that. Except most of us make a mistake about that that I'll come to. We know that the Antichrist comes from the Roman Empire in its extension. And the most fundamental passage for end time Bible studies is the 70 weeks of Daniel, the last four verses of Daniel chapter 9. And if you haven't studied that, one of the things you want to do is undertake a diligent study of the last four verses of Daniel 9. If you understand those four verses, then everything else will fall into place. Now, people who are confused about those four verses will turn out to have all kinds of other problems in trying to lay out the end time scenario. The 70 weeks consist of four verses, verse 24, which gives you the scope of the whole thing, then 69 weeks of years in verse 25, and then an interval, and then a final seven-year period in verse 27. Those are the four segments that make up this fabulous passage. The 69 weeks are in and of themselves the most profound substantiation of the Word of God than you could find. Gabriel gives Daniel a precise mathematical formula that from the commandment to restore unto Jerusalem and to the Mashiach Nagi, the Messiah, the King, will be 173,880 days. That's essentially what he says. And we know that what the decree was to restore Jerusalem, and we also know the date that Jesus, the only date he allowed himself to be presented as a king, was Palm Sunday. It turns out that Gabriel told Daniel virtually five centuries in advance the exact day that the Messiah would present himself to Jerusalem. What makes this particularly provocative, on this timeline, less than halfway through this time, is when the entire Old Testament was translated into Greek, called the Septuagint version. That was about 300 years prior to Christ's ministry. So setting aside who wrote Daniel and when he wrote it and all that, it almost doesn't matter. It was in black and white three centuries before Christ's ministry, and it predicts with a precision that's astonishing. But after this famous 69 weeks, which I encourage you to really dig into and get the background on, there is an interval in verse 9:26. In verse 9:26 says, "And after 62 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off," cut out, or executed, "but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined." Now, the very fact that the Messiah is predicted to be executed is in the Old Testament is astonishing to many. But as we know, he was. And then there's this interesting phrase, "And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary." Well, obviously that happened in 70 AD. And in fact, Jesus predicted it the week that he was crucified. He made a very explicit prediction in Luke chapter 19 and elsewhere. And we all know that the Roman legions had laid an eight-month siege, slaughtered virtually a million people, and destroyed the city and the sanctuary. But the people that did that, of course, were the Roman legions. We have here in the middle of this passage a phrase, "the prince that shall come," that's one of 33 titles in the Old Testament that make an allusion to this coming world leader that we tend to call the Antichrist. But here it says, "the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary." Well, we know who destroyed the city and the sanctuary were the Roman legions. And this is one of the several passages that identify this prince that shall come, the Antichrist, if you will, as being emerging, if you will, from the Roman Empire. And the prince that shall come. Now, this interval is indeterminate. Jesus is crucified during that interval. The city of the sanctuary destroyed. So that's 38 years at least between these two, between verse 25 and verse 27. Through experience, we've discovered that verse 26 is endured for better part of 2,000 years. But the day is coming when this interval will be over. The church period will be over. And events will trigger a final seven-year period, which some scholars call the 70th week of Daniel, in which all kinds of things take place. That's not our purpose to go into all that here in this brief time. But we do have this identity from this passage that this coming world leader is from the Roman Empire. Well, here's where most of us, ourselves included, suffer from a myopia, because we tend to think, when we think of the Roman Empire, we tend to think of Western Europe. We think of the Roman Empire in terms of its Western leg, if you will, when it literally, and also in the Bible, is presented as having two legs, an Eastern and a Western leg. We tend to overlook the Eastern leg of the Roman Empire because, in our parlance, most of us call it the Byzantine Empire. We give it another label. But it actually is simply the Eastern leg of the Roman Empire, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And one of the possibilities that seems to be suggested all through the Scripture is that this coming world leader is, yes, from the Roman Empire, but not its Western leg, but from the Eastern leg. And that shatters a lot of the presumptions that so many of us have encountered in reading books and watching maps and so forth in this area. Let's take a good look at, or a quick look at Daniel chapter 2. Most of us are familiar with this dramatic dream that the young king Nebuchadnezzar had, where he had a dream and he asked his advisors to interpret it for him. They couldn't. They called upon Daniel, and Daniel, of course, did. And he not only told Nebuchadnezzar what his dream was, but he also interpreted what it meant. So that's all in chapter 2. And what Nebuchadnezzar saw in his dream was a metal image. And its head was of gold, its arms and chest of silver, belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron. And we're going to discover that this portrays four empires that will endure between Daniel and the fifth empire that God himself establishes on the planet Earth. Just four empires, not three, not seven, four. And this last empire, the fourth one, goes into a strange phase where it's iron and iron mixed with clay. If we didn't have other visibility, we'd assume there are five empires, except it's going to be very clear that there's four by the interpretation and by other visions that impinge on this. Well, what Nebuchadnezzar saw was a rock, a stone cut without hands, which clobbered this, the feet of this, this metal image, and that stone grew to be a mountain that filled the whole earth. That is the whole earth, not just the local region. The good news is Daniel interpreted this for us. The gold, he explains, is Babylon. It's both the king Nebuchadnezzar and the empire that he represents. But he goes on to explain that you're going to be succeeded by another, and that would be the Persian Empire. And it, in turn, will be succeeded by another, the Greek Empire. And it, in turn, will be succeeded by Rome, and I'm going to call it Rome Phase 1. Because in the vision, that fourth empire breaks into pieces, gets divided, but then is seen to come back together in a final form, which we're just going to call Rome Phase 2. And of course, the stone cut without hands is none other than the stone which the builders rejected. The one that, it's an idiom, of course, of Jesus Christ. You know, it's amazing to take an idiom like a rock or a stone and discover how consistently it is used rhetorically throughout the entire Scripture. Paul in 1 Corinthians 10:4 can say that rock that followed him through the wilderness where the water came out of was Christ. That doesn't mean literally. He's speaking of it, of course, rhetorically. But it's interesting whether it's the rock in the wilderness that gave the water, the living water, or whether it's the stone cut without hands, or and so forth. Check your Bible and with the concordance, and it's astonishing to see how consistently the Holy Spirit uses the idioms all the way through. Most scholars recognize that the iron and the iron mixed with clay is an empire in two phases. Now, Babylon, of course, was dominant on the planet Earth from about 606 to about 539 BC, where it was conquered when they were conquered by Cyrus the Persian, and from 539 to about 332 BC, when Alexander the Great establishes the Greek Empire. He dies, but his four generals take over, and we'll talk more about that. And ultimately, though, Rome takes over the Greek Empire. Rome emerges about 68 BC, about 44 BC, Julius Caesar is assassinated, 31 BC is the Battle of Actium. It's about 64 AD is when Nero begins his persecutions. Then 284 AD, Diocletian does several things that are worthy of note to us. One is he divides the empire into two parts. By then it has grown. See, among other things, he also was able to get the formal surrender of Mesopotamia from Iran. So the empire had grown so large that it wasn't manageable. So he appoints a co-regent to help him. That's where we begin to sense that it's breaking into two legs. We always see image of Nebuchadnezzar as presumably a man standing with two legs, and he has 10 toes. That's going to be important later. Many of us fail to recognize that in the idiom of the image is also suggested that there's two legs, if you will. They're not of equal length because the western leg evaporates in about 476. Anyway, Diocletian divides it into two armed with a co-regent. Constantine gets so fed up with the paganism in Rome that he relocates the primary capital of the world from Rome to Byzantium, which he renames Constantinople, or the New Rome. And, of course, that's his capital. But it's about 476 A.D. that the empire starts to break into pieces. But when I say the empire, I mean the western part of the empire starts to decay. And each of the pieces has had a bid at world dominion over the centuries. You can go ahead and trace all that from the Dutch, the French, the British, the Spanish, and the Germans, and so forth. But none of them quite ever establishing the comprehensive empire that had preceded it. Now, incidentally, Rome absorbs Greece in 146 B.C. Lysimachus, that's one of Alexander's four generals, in 133. Seleucus, 64 B.C. Egypt, 31 B.C. It's interesting, each of these elements disappear from the scene before the birth of Christ. But the eastern leg of the Roman Empire endures 1,000 years after the western leg fell. The western leg fell about 476 A.D., started to really break up into pieces. And the eastern leg endured till 1453, when it was finally overrun by the Muslims. But we're going to focus on one of these especially, Seleucus' kingdom of 64 B.C., because Daniel, in Daniel 7 and Daniel 8, has much to say about this that's far more relevant to us than simply history. It's also predictive. So we're going to take a look at that. And of course, we've had a lot of attention in our own prophetic horizon because the Roman Empire seems to be getting ready for what we'll call Phase 2. The Treaty of Paris, the Treaties of Rome in the middle 16th century, the Parliament in 58, and we won't go through all the details, but obviously it is increasingly grown till in 1993 the Maastricht Treaty replaced the Treaty of Rome, which provides for a United States of Europe, if you will, common foreign policy, common military, common currency, and the euro, of course, is making its beginning. So there's been much attention on Europe as the emergent superstate, but a lot of that driven by the presumption that out of that will come the Antichrist. And indeed he may, except we're going to take a look at what Daniel and some of the other prophets have had to say about all this. In Daniel chapter 7, we now shift. Daniel had his experience with Nebuchadnezzar when he was a young man, and Nebuchadnezzar was also just taken over. The scene will shift in Daniel 7 towards the end of his time in Babylon, and he's going to talk about we talked about the Daniel chapter 2, the many polymetallic image, Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. These same empires are profiled for Daniel by God directly, with a vision directly given to Daniel. Same subject, different idioms. Nebuchadnezzar saw it as man sees it, as a series of bright shiny metals. God presented to Daniel the way he sees it, as a string or a series of voracious beasts. In Daniel chapter 7, he sees a creature that looks sort of like a winged lion. Then it's followed by a bear that rises up on one side. And that's followed by a leopard that's moves so fast that he hardly touches the ground. And then there's the fourth one is so terrible, Daniel can't even find a comfortable parallel. He just calls it the great and terrible beast. And it's the one that has the 10 heads. And all these idioms are echoed for us all through the scripture, including the book of Revelation. So these idioms become very familiar to us if you study prophecy. But in Daniel chapter 7, We're going to take a look at some of the verses. It says, these great, in, starting about verse 17, these great beasts, which are four, there again, you see, you have the emphasis on four, not five, four. That last one is in two phases, is the point. Which are four kings, or kingdoms, the same word in the Hebrew, melech, shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. Then Daniel says, then I would know the truth of the fourth beast. It's interesting that Daniel doesn't ask questions of his visitor about the first, second, or third. He zeroes in on the fourth one, and we're grateful for that, because that's the one we think we know about the other three from history. The fourth one is the big mystery. Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, exceedingly dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, his nails of brass, which devoured, brake in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet. And of the ten horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, before whom three fell, even that horn that had eyes, and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. So we know it's a person. But notice there are ten horns. Those ten horns are going to be echoed through so many prophecies that are very familiar to us in the Scripture, that so familiar that we overlook the 11th. And the of the other which came up. So it's 10 plus 1. This final super leader you could call the 11th horn. Are we together? Okay. And I beheld that same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. Now that should startle you. The Antichrist is going to make war with the saints and prevail against him. That's what it is in Daniel 7. You remember in Revelation 13 has the famous two beasts that was given unto him to make war with the saints, and guess what? To overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds, tongues, and nations. And because of these comments, that's why many people jump to the conclusion that the church will go through the tribulation, because they're going to be suffer at the hands of the Antichrist. That's because so many of us, most people have a problem. People who think the church goes through the tribulation don't have a problem with eschatology, they have a problem with ecclesiology, to understand the nature and the uniqueness of the church. Not all saints are members of the church. And to understand that, you need to understand carefully about John the Baptist, as an example. Jesus said, "Of no man born of woman is greater than John the Baptist." That's pretty good. That's pretty exciting. And in his next breath, he says, "He that's least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John." What on earth did he mean by that? Are you saying that John is not saved? No. But he's not. He's because a few verses later, he explains that the law and the prophets were until John. John the Baptist closes the Old Testament. Luke 16:16, Matthew 11, you can look it up. The point is, understand there were people that were saved in the Old Testament. There are people that will be saved during the tribulation, but they're not in the church. The church is a uniquely blessed subgroup, if you will. Not all elect or all saints are in the same category. And in fact, the word prevailed against them and overcome them, it's the same concept. When you get to Matthew 16:18 at Caesarea Philippi, Jesus makes a statement that's very important. He says, "I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not," what? "Prevail against it." And that's in contradistinction to both the Old and New Testament revelations, both in Revelation 13:7 and Daniel 7:21-22. So the point is, what I'm trying to get across is recognize the church has a distinctive in that it won't be in the tribulation for a number of reasons. But in any case, let's move on. I beheld the same horn made war with the saints that prevailed against them, until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. And then it goes on. And thus he said, "The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down and break it in pieces. And the ten horns out of this kingdom are ten kings that shall arise." It doesn't say those ten kings come together to create that empire. They arise out of that empire. "Another shall arise after them." There's the another again. "And he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue three kings." So you have 10, he's going to subdue 3, that gives you the 7, you'll see that come up again and again. But again, we have this another, I'm going to call him the 11th horn. Daniel 7 gives us some other insight into the guy. He shall speak great words against the Most High. You know, that's the most consistent descriptor of the Antichrist. You'll find it all through the book of Revelation, all through the Old Testament. If you want a nickname for this guy, call him Mr. Big Mouth. Because he's always sounding off, every place you see him. He shall speak great words against the Most High. He shall wear out the saints of the Most High. And think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until, and here's one of these quaint phrases, a time and times and the dividing of time. Now you and I, in our language, generally have a singular or a plural. But some languages, in Hebrew and Aramaic, have what's called a dual. You have a singular, a dual, and a plural. The only place I know of that occurring in English, I'll give you an example. If I say, tomorrow night we're going to have all our friends over for dinner, both of them. You laugh because that means it's only two, see? The word both implies not a plurality, it implies it's like a dual. It's not quite the same thing, but it gives you the idea. Anyway, the point is, what we have here is time, singular, times, it happens to be a dual, and the dividing or splitting of time. So this is 1 + 2.5, that's a way of saying 3.5 years. It occurs many times in Scripture. The same period of time is called in some places 42 months, in other places 1260 days. The Holy Spirit has done everything imaginable to point out that's specific and literal, not just symbolic. It's in years, it's in months, it's in days. The only thing he didn't do is spell it out in nanoseconds. Maybe in code it is there too, I haven't looked, but that's one. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it unto the end. And the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. Hitherto is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me, but I kept the matter in my heart. So that's Daniel chapter 7. Now Daniel chapter 8 focuses on the Persian Empire and the Greeks taking it over. And that has relevance for us because it goes beyond the history that it's focusing on. Let's take a look at it. This occurs about 2 years after the vision in Daniel 7, about 12 years before the fall of Babylon described in Daniel chapter 5. It's a vision of a ram and a male goat. The ram will be defeated by the goat from the west. The notable horn of the goat divides into four, and the little horn that will emerge has a very key role at the very end. And the language about that is very perplexing. We'll take a look at it. Now Daniel will interpret this for us and point out that this leader from the west is, of course, turns out to be Alexander the Great, and he'll subdue the Medo-Persian Empire, which of course is symbolized by the ram, which happens, by the way, to be its symbol and on its shields and so on. But anyway, Alexander's four generals, when they die, they're going to divide up the empire. Cassander will take Macedonia and Greece. Lysimachus will take Thrace, Bithynia, most of Asia Minor, what you and I would call Turkey. Ptolemy takes the south, primarily Egypt, Cyrene, and so forth. Seleucus takes Syria and the lands east, all the way to India. Ptolemy and Seleucus have the lion's share here, and they will have rivalry through a half a dozen dynastic followers. So I might mention under Ptolemy is when the Septuagint translation translates all of this material into the precision of Greek. And Seleucus will have Antioch's Epiphanes as the little horn. We'll talk about that. In Daniel chapter 8, the first 8 verses talk about Alexander the Great. Then from verses 9 to 14, it speaks of a particular leader called Antiochus Epiphanes, who is the one that really, his atrocities on the Jews led to the Maccabean revolt. Verses 20 through 22 of this chapter, Daniel goes and interprets the first 8 verses for you. And verses 23 to 25, he interprets the significance of the remarks about Antiochus Epiphanes, and they go far beyond Antiochus Epiphanes himself. So it's a very interesting passage. Let's just take a sampling of it. In Daniel chapter 8, verse 2, we'll start. Daniel says, I saw in a vision, it came to pass when I saw that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river Ulai. These are places in Persia, not in Babylon. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns. And the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other. And the higher came up last. And this seems to be an allusion to Cyrus, the Persian, who was half Persian, half Mede, and his strength came from uniting the Medes and the Persians into a consolidated empire. The Medes were stronger at first, the Persians came up later, but they were the dominant ones. Many people just call it the Persian Empire. But it actually was his mother and his father, one was Mede, one was Persian. He bridged both. And he, of course, is considered one of the great leaders in world history. But moving on, Daniel says, I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him, neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering, behold, a he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. So here's a goat moving so fast, it doesn't even seem to be touching the ground. And if anything describes Alexander's career, it's staggering. Young man that conquered, within 11 years, the known world. But his main defeat was the defeat of the Persians. A notable horn, that's our friend Alexander. And he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran into him with the fury of his power. And I saw him come close into the ram, and he was moved with choler against him. And he smote the ram and brake his two horns, and there was no power in the ram to stand before him. And he cast him down to the ground and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore the he-goat waxed very great. Get this. When he was strong, the great horn was broken. And for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. As a young man, you might regard at the peak of his career, he dies. His capital was in Babylon. And as he's dying, the legend has it that they ask him, to whom does the empire go? He says, give it to the strong. Great way to settle a dispute. But in any case, the four generals divided up. And we're going to talk now about the little horn in Antiochus Epiphanes. And out of one of them, that's one of these four horns, came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land. The pleasant land being an idiom, of course, for Israel. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. Now, up till now, you can attribute most of what's being said to Antiochus IV, who called himself Epiphanes, who made reading the Torah a capital crime. He forbid them to make offerings in the temple. In fact, he slaughtered a sow on the golden altar, on the brazen altar. If you understand how the Jews feel about pork and how they feel about the brazen altar, you can imagine how that went over. He didn't stop there. He erected an idol to the pagan god Zeus in the Holy of Holies. And that did it. That incensed a revolt called the Maccabean Revolt. And they threw off the yoke of that empire and were able to rededicate the temple that had been desecrated. And they celebrate that event to this very day in Hanukkah. That's what the Jewish celebration of Hanukkah is really all about. But moving on, the ram which thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Median Persia. So we skipped to verse 20. Daniel is interpreting this passage for you in his writings. The ram which thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Media and Persia. The rough goat is the king of Greece. And the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king. That's obviously Alexander. Now that being broken, whereas the four stood up for it, four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation, but not in his power. After Alexander's death, what happens? Four generals divided up. Macedonia and Greece, Cassander, Asia Minor and Thrace, Lysimachus, Syria and Babylon, Seleucus, Egypt, Arabia and Syria, Israel, although that was contested by Ptolemy. We're going to look carefully at both Seleucus and Ptolemy because it unveils what's coming on our own horizon. We're going to look in Daniel 11 from verses 5 to 35 is a detailed rundown of the tensions between Seleucus and Ptolemy. Seleucus being called there the kings of the north, Ptolemy called the kings of the south in Daniel 11. Very key passage for us to understand. Continuing in Daniel 8, from verse 23 on, the language starts to go beyond its applicability to Antiochus Epiphanes. It says, in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences shall stand up. Most scholars believe this is piercing beyond Antiochus Epiphanes. It's looking to the last of the line, which will be the Antichrist. For a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences stand up, and his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power, and he shall destroy wonderfully, and he shall prosper and practice, and shall destroy the mighty and holy people. And through his policy also he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand, and he shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall destroy many. Wow. By peace he shall destroy many. He shall also stand up against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without hand. So most scholars recognize this as an allusion to the person we call the Antichrist. Well, let's take a look at Daniel 11 for what insights it will give us. The first two verses talk about the Persian Empire. And I won't go through the list of these, although there's some very important people here. Not only Cyrus, who is detailed in Daniel 5 and also Isaiah 45. There's a letter written to him by name by God 150 years before he's born. Xerxes 1 is probably we believe is the king of Esther, the book of Esther. And Artaxerxes Longimanus is the one that triggers the 70-week prophecy of Daniel. He gave Nehemiah the authority to rebuild the city. But from verse 3 and 4, we talk about Alexander the Great. And that, of course, has been detailed for us in Daniel 8 for us. And that follows then, what follows after verse 4 are when the generals divide the empire. And again, we're going to focus on, and the passage focuses on primarily Seleucus and Ptolemy. I won't take you through the details because we don't have time, but if you look through 5 through 35, you'll discover that there's kings of the south fighting the kings of the north, and the details there fit history so precisely that critics of the Bible have tried to argue that Daniel must be a fraud and must have been written after the fact. That overlooks the fact that long before this list is over, the entire Old Testament is translated into Greek. So it's hard for someone to forge into an already translated and widely distributed set of documents, but that's obviously nonsense. But the Ptolemies, we go through 6 cycles of the Ptolemies, and we go through 8 cycles of the Seleucids. But the most notable one is the last one, Antiochus Epiphanes, because he's so prominent in triggering the rebellion in Israel. So we'll leave it at that. But from verse 36 on now, we're talking about Antiochus Epiphanes again, but here again, the language will go far beyond Antiochus himself. Let's take a look at it. Verse 36, and the king shall do according to his will. There's the willful king. And he shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that which is determined shall be done. Now this can be applied sort of to Antiochus Epiphanes, but the language seems to go far beyond anything he did. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. And in his estate shall he honor the God of forces, and a God whom his fathers knew not, shall he honor with gold and silver and with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus shall he do in the most strongholds with a strange God, whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and shall divide the land for gain. And at the time of the end, now at this point, see, from verse 36 to 40, you can sort of argue that maybe just flowery language talking about Antiochus Epiphanes. But from verse 40 to the end of the chapter, it's clearly far beyond Antiochus Epiphanes. But it's as if he's looking through him to the end time. And at the time of the end, shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind with chariots, and with horsemen, and with many ships, and he shall enter into the countries, and shall overflow, and pass over. He shall also enter into the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown. But these shall escape out of his hand, Edom, and Moab, and the chief children of Ammon. Boy, that's a strange thing. This particular piece of ground, which we today would call Jordan, for some reason, eludes his grasp. Most scholars speculate that it's to give the remnant a place to flee to. But that's conjecture. He shall stretch forth his hand also upon the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. And he shall have power over the treasures of gold and of silver, and over all the precious things of Egypt, and the Libyans, and the Ethiopians shall be at his steps. But tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him. Now that's kind of interesting, especially if you've been following world events and you understand the Shanghai Pact, where China and Russia have joined forces against the United States by treaty, joined by most of the players in Central Asia. And that when NATO redefined itself as a global police force in 1999, that chilled not only our enemies but also our allies. But China and Russia and most of Central Asia signed the Shanghai Pact. And it's interesting that the threat he sees here comes out of the east and out of the north. It shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go forth with great fury to destroy and utterly to make many, to make away many. And he shall plant the tabernacles of his palace between the seas in the glorious holy mountain. Yet, and it's interesting, most scholars recognize that must mean between the Dead Sea and the Mediterranean. And some scholars speculate that may somehow involve the temple that's described in the last few chapters of Ezekiel. Because that temple is not in Jerusalem. And so there's speculations that about that that deserve some study. He shall plant his tabernacles of his palace between the seas and the glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end and none shall help him. Well, let's shift now, and let's take a look at the book of Revelation. Chapter 13, of course, is the main passage of the Antichrist in the book of Revelation. The first two verses, John says, I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns. And upon his horns, ten crowns. And upon his heads, the name of blasphemy. And the beast I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet was as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, his seat, and his great authority. Who's the dragon? From the previous chapter, chapter 12, verse 9, it's identified, of course, as none other than Satan. But there's something else that's noteworthy here. You notice that there's a leopard, a bear, and a lion. That echoes in our ears because we remember those are the principal idioms used in Daniel chapter 7. The lion was Babylon, the bear was Persia, and the leopard was Greece. But you notice they're in the backward order here. See, when Daniel was given the vision, it was yet future. John is looking backward in time, so they're inverted. Interesting. But somehow, this final empire bears marks of all its three precedents. And worthy of note. Satan has seven super kingdoms. In Revelation 12, verse 3, it says, there appeared another wonder in heaven, behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads and ten horns. There it is again, and seven crowns upon his heads. Where on earth do we get seven empires? Well, you see, we're familiar with Daniel's 4 plus 1, but Daniel wrote in the days of Babylon. Prior to him, there were two major empires, Egypt and Assyria. And so if you take the two precedent, if you start from the beginning, there's Egypt, Assyria, then Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome in two phases. And so... and of course, the second phase of the Roman Empire having the ten horns is well detailed in Daniel 2, 7, and 8, and we've looked at those passages. Now, don't let these last five confuse you, because again, it's Daniel's 4 plus 1, if you will, Roman two phases. Once you understand that, then everything starts to make some sense here. And most scholars recognize that the Roman Empire is, as I say, in two phases, what I'll call phase 1 and phase 2. Well, when you get to Revelation 17, says, and there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Now, this is pretty straightforward. Five are fallen. This is being penned by John, and behind him are five empires, Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Persia, and Greece. That makes sense. There are seven kings, five are fallen, and one is. The one that's around right then, namely Rome. Paul was in exile on the Isle of Patmos when he was penning this from Rome. And the other is not yet come. Okay, that's the seventh. That's the last one. It's the phase two of Rome, if you will. It's the last one, sort of. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Okay. The next verse, Revelation 17:11, and the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. What on earth can that mean? Taken by itself, it sounds like it's contradictory. The beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. That passage has puzzled scholars for centuries. But let's, in this background, let's take a look at this. The beast that was and is not, even he's the eighth. Well, that's the 11th horn of the second of the final empire. He's the eighth, what I'll call the 11th horn. And he's of the seven. That means then he's of, somehow of the seven. But there's another clue here. It says that was and is not. Which of those seven has disappeared from history? One of the great mysteries of archaeology is that there were many, many experts that didn't believe the story of Jonah because they didn't believe there ever existed a city called Nineveh. And it may astonish you to discover that they didn't know anything about it in an archaeological sense until the gold rush in California. Not that it had anything to do with it, I just mentioned that you should remember the date. In 1849, Layard was the committed person that made history by discovering Nineveh. Alexander the Great, Napoleon, many world conquerors walked over it not even knowing it was there because it was buried. And Layard, in 1849, discovered Nineveh. And today, it's well known. Of course, his discovery ushered in a craze in archaeology in that whole region. But one of the mysteries about the Assyrian Empire is how it not only rose to power tremendously, but it disappears so quickly without a trace. Without a trace. And so it's interesting that there are vestiges of all the rest of these out here. Egypt's still around. Babylon in various forms has had different lives, if you will. Persia, Greece, Rome, of course, all visible. And so the speculation is that the beast that was and is not, even he's the eighth, but he is of the seven and goeth into perdition. Now, you say, gee, what on earth is this leading to? Well, let's take another look at a couple of other verses in the scripture. Micah chapter 5 has something to say about this. It says, in this one, this man shall be the peace. I think he's speaking of the Messiah, but then he goes in, when the Assyrian shall come into our land, and when he shall tread in our palaces, then shall we rise against him seven shepherds and eight principal men. And they shall waste the land of Assyria with the sword, and the land of Nimrod in the entrances thereof. Thus shall he deliver us from the Assyrian when he cometh into our land, and when he treadeth within our borders. The Assyrian. The land of Nimrod. Do you pick up that? What on earth is Micah talking about? And that's what we're going to explore a little further. But I want you to notice something. In recent years, in 1906, Iran became an independent republic. From the old Roman Empire, these previously subsumed entities have reemerged. 1921, Afghanistan. 22, Egypt. 22, Iraq. 24, Turkey. 1930, Lebanon. 1938, Syria. 1946, Jordan. 1947, Pakistan, both Jordan and Pakistan being synthetic countries built to appease the Muslims. And 1948, this nation Israel. It's interesting that in our recent history, all the pieces have resurfaced, perhaps to be recoalesced in this final super empire. Egypt, of course, was Ptolemy. Seleucus were the rest of these. Seleucus and Lysimachus, if you talk Turkey. But out of these, Iraq and Syria are those regions, those are the names by which they're known today, that way back constituted the empire known as Assyria, which incidentally was the place from which the first world dictator sprung. The first dictator, Nimrod, and perhaps the last will be an echo of that. And we'll take a look at that in our next session. Nimrod II, the 11th king.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to undertake part two of our series, and I'll just call this one Nimrod the Second, the 11th king, taking it from Micah 5:5, when the Assyrians shall come into our land. And, you know, it's interesting, there are many titles of this person that we tend to call the Antichrist. In the New Testament, he's the angel of the bottomless pit, or at least that's an allusion to him. We tend to call him the Antichrist. That Greek term actually means the pseudo-Christ, or instead of Christ. Our term tends to imply he's against Christ, and he certainly is, but the term actually implies being a substitute for Christ. He's called the beast, of course, in Revelation 11, the false prophet in Revelation 13, the father of the lie, lawless one, man of sin. There's many of these titles. Son of perdition, man of sin, are the ones I've mentioned are the most common ones. In the Old Testament, there are 33 allusions, as listed by Arthur W. Pink, as an example. And I won't go through all of these, in the interest of time, but there are a few that you should be sensitive to. We're noticing that the word Assyrian seems to be used by Isaiah and Micah and Ezekiel and elsewhere as an idiom of this coming final world leader. Zechariah calls him the idol shepherd, I-D-O-L, not idol like lazy, but idol like false worship. The idol shepherd. In fact, it's the only physical description we have of him in the Bible, to my knowledge, is in the last few verses of Zechariah 11. We saw him called the little horn in Daniel 7 and Daniel 8. In Daniel 9:26, he's called the prince that shall come. We explored that. You could even argue that in Genesis 3:15, he's the seed of the serpent. We all know about the seed of the woman. The seed of the serpent is the contrary seed. And he's called the willful king in Daniel 11, and many other labels. But let's take a look at some allusions that we find through the Old Testament. I've just done a sampling here. In Isaiah chapter 10, Isaiah says, "It will come to pass in that day that the remnant of Israel and such as are escaped of the house of Jacob shall no more again stay upon him that smote them, but shall stay upon the Lord, the Holy One of Israel in truth. The remnant shall return, even the remnant of Jacob, unto the mighty God." And he goes on, he says, "For though thy people Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, yet a remnant of them shall return, a consumption decreed shall overflow with righteousness. For the Lord God of hosts shall make a consumption even determined in the midst of all the land." And then in the next verse it says, "Therefore thus saith the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwelleth in Zion, be not afraid of the Assyrian. He shall smite thee with a rod, and shall lift up his staff against thee, after the manner of Egypt. And yet a very little while, and the indignation shall cease, and mine anger in their destruction." There are a number of Old Testament passages which allude to the Great Tribulation in terms of time of indignation. So that it's possible. This could have other constructions. It's possible this is alluding to that. When you get to Isaiah 14, that's familiar to most of you diligent students of the Scripture as a passage that speaks of the origin of Satan in Isaiah 14. Starting about verse 12, it says, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations?" Now this is piercing the local situation, and certainly has in focus a super leader. We assume it's Lucifer himself. "For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will sit also upon the mount of congregation, the sides of the north, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, I will be like the Most High." And this, of course, is the issue of pride. That's one reason God hates pride, because it's through pride that sin entered the creation. But then it goes on, it says, "Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, Is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness, and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of his prisoners?" Now you can quickly tell this raises a lot of interesting questions of origins and what happened, when did all this sort of thing happen. But then notice what he says in the next verse, "That I will break the Assyrian in my land, and upon my mountains tread him underfoot. Then shall his yoke depart from off of them, and his burden depart from off their shoulders." So again, in this very famous passage, very foundational passage in Isaiah 14, we find the term Assyrian used. Now some commentators jump to the conclusion that it's probably just used there idiomatically because he's used as a general for the specific or specific for the general, as a rhetorical device to speak of this evil leader, calling him an Assyrian. In other words, using it connotatively rather than denotatively. But that's an assumption on the commentators. And some people would say that this passage refers to when the Assyrians were attacking the northern kingdom, which indeed they did. They took them captive. But notice the next verses. This is the purpose that is purposed upon the whole earth. And this is the hand that is stretched out upon all the nations. So the scope of this is hardly focusing on the northern kingdom issue by Isaiah. The scope of this is far, far, far broader, whatever it's talking about. There's lots of possibilities. But the term Assyrian here does catch our notice. Let's take a quick look at Isaiah 30. And the Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard, and shall show the lighting down of his arm with the indignation of his anger, and with the flame of a devouring fire, with the scattering and tempest and hailstones. For through the voice of the Lord shall the Assyrian be beaten down, which smote with a rod. There it is again. Let's take a look at Ezekiel. Ezekiel has some strange stuff. And I'll just take a couple of sample verses here. It said, "Behold, the Assyrian was a cedar in Lebanon, with fair branches and with a shadowing shroud, and of a high stature, and his top was among the thick boughs." And the whole passage tends to use trees as idioms for soldiers or leaders. That happens several places. Again, in the scriptures, consistent. Remember in Daniel chapter 4, that's the chapter in the Bible that was written by Nebuchadnezzar himself. It's his testimony. But there it involves a vision of a tree that was cut down, referring to himself. A leader. So that's an idiom that is familiar to your ears if you study your Old Testament. But it goes on then a few verses later, "All the fowls of heaven made their nests in his boughs." If you remember the kingdom parables of Matthew 13, that should echo in your ears. Because the birds there were the ministers of Satan. "And under his branches did all the beasts of the field bring forth their young, and under his shadow dwelt all the great nations." It goes on. Get down a few verses later, "The cedars of the garden of God could not hide him." What on earth is he talking about? Garden of God? "The fir trees were not like his boughs, the chestnut trees were not like his branches, nor any tree in the garden of God was like unto him in his beauty. I have made him fair by the multitude of his branches, so that all the trees of Eden that were in the garden of God envied him." Wait a minute. What's he doing in the garden of God in the first place? What's he doing in Eden? "I made the nations shake at the sound of his fall when I cast him down to hell with them that descend into the pit, and all the trees of Eden, the choice and best of Lebanon, all that drink water shall be comforted in the nether parts of the earth." Strange stuff. And let's go take another look at Micah 5 again. "This man shall be the peace when the Assyrian shall come into our land, when he shall tread in our palaces. Then shall we raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 principal men. And they shall waste the land of Assyria with the sword, and the land of Nimrod, and the entrances thereof. Thus shall he deliver us from the Assyrian when he cometh into our land, when he treadeth within our borders." There it is. All this talking about an Assyrian again. See this? And the land of Nimrod again. So again, all this echoes back to the earliest empires. And you remember Nimrod was the first world dictator. He built a number of cities, Babel, Bab Tower El God, a tower to God, and Akkad, and Erech, and Nineveh, Sumer, and Calah. And it's interesting that we're talking about a guy and a region that was the beginning of all civilization. And his capital was a place called Babylon. Now what's fascinating about this issue is there is another raging controversy among conservative Bible scholars. And that is, what on earth does the scripture mean when it talks about the future Babylon? And first of all, you need to understand there's some problems having to do with the doom of Babylon as described in the Bible. You see, Isaiah 13 and Isaiah 14 and Jeremiah 50 and 51 detail the destruction of Babylon. And among the phrases that occur in those passages, I'm sparing you going through it in detail, because particularly Jeremiah passages are somewhat lengthy. We could spend a full 2 hours just discussing the subtleties. But the main points of those passages in Isaiah 13 and 14 and Jeremiah 50 and 51 include the fact that it's going to be destroyed in a very sudden catastrophic way. It will, after destroyed, it will never again be inhabited. Both of them make that emphasis. In fact, not only will it not be inhabited, the building materials that make up the city of Babylon will never again be reused. That's kind of strange. Maybe they're ionized. Who knows? They're going to be destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. Both Isaiah and Jeremiah use that very phrase. Now, we all recall Genesis 19, where God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah in a very catastrophic, final, deliberate way in the matter of hours. And it's kind of interesting to study Genesis 19 very carefully, because the two angels that go there aren't there just to do Lot a favor getting he and his family out. If you read the text carefully, you'll discover that it was a prerequisite condition for the judgment of those cities for them to get out. In fact, the chapter before, Abraham's negotiating with God. What if there's 10 righteous, and so on. And the principle that clearly comes through that passage of Genesis 18, 19 is that the righteous were removed before the judgment. Interesting. But the main problem that occurs here is the destruction of Babylon, as described in the Old Testament, has never happened. Many people, many Bible handbooks and things are confused on this. They assume that when the Persians conquered Babylon, there was a fight. There wasn't a fight. But what Cyrus's general did, he succeeded in diverting the water of the river Euphrates that allowed them to slip under the gates and take the town over without a battle. If you go to the London Museum, you can see the cylinder of Cyrus where he brags to the world that he conquered this impregnable capital without a battle, by just clever generalship on his officers. And so, in fact, many people that were living there for 3 days didn't even know it had been taken over. It was just a coup, if you will. And so the point is, Babylon was not destroyed by the Persians. It was a secondary capital. 2 centuries later, when Alexander conquers the Persians, he makes it his capital. That's where he died. Well, he has base. He actually died nearby. But anyway, the point is that you can get, even in the 75 AD, the merchants are still trying to make a go of it. The Seleucid Empire built a rival city that was more conveniently located for the caravan routes, and so it took the traffic, and Babylon just eroded to irrelevance. But as late as the 1800s, when Koldewey, the German archaeologist, was excavating, he could hire local people to help him. There were people living there. So when you read the passage in the scripture, it's clear that it has been inhabited. The building materials were reused to make temporary shelters and so forth. It has never been destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. That's the big dilemma. And there are scholars that believe that in order for the Bible to be true, Babylon has to rise to prominence in order to be destroyed in a manner that fits the text. And they're a minority. Now, don't confuse the destruction of Babylon with the fall of Babylon in 539 BC, as I've just gone through. Okay. And by the way, it's presently being rebuilt. Now, many Bible scholars laugh at it because what's being done is rather modest. Millions and millions of dollars being spent. They've rebuilt Nebuchadnezzar's palace, where the handwriting on the wall was. The archaeologists confirmed the foundations. They rebuilt it. In 1987, Saddam Hussein used it for affairs of state. So the press regards it as Disneyland East or something. They make fun of it. But the truth of the matter is, Babylon's being rebuilt. And if you look at the charts, the military charts for Desert Storm, if you have any friends that were in that role, you'll see about 62 miles southeast of Baghdad are some buildings, it says numerous small buildings. No, excuse me, numerous large buildings. But anyway, they're not labeled as Babylon, they're just there by the village of Hillel. But now the question, of course, that arises when people address the book of Revelation. Because the book of Revelation also describes Babylon in some strange terms. But it also describes it in 1 hour it's going to be destroyed. It also describes a catastrophic destruction. And now, Mystery Babylon, Revelation 17, 18. In chapter 17 of the two, it's described in more or less religious terms. There it's described as the great whore. And she rides the beast with seven heads and ten horns. Don't confuse Babylon with a beast, because Babylon is riding the beast. She is also called the mother of harlots and abominations. She also is described as being drunk with the blood of the saints. And we're indebted to a number of great scholars of the past that have really dug into this. The classic work in this, at one time, was Alexander Hislop's book, The Two Babylons. He was one of the first. It was, for many years, probably the primary text. Until Dave Hunt wrote a book called A Woman Rides the Beast. And his book is the best documented book on the subject, bar none. He does a thorough job. He links the practices of ancient Babylon with the current practices of the Vatican. And clearly, there is a deep spiritual connection between the Roman Catholic practices, the pagan practices that populate that church, and Babylonianism. Now, obviously, that's a book that has a high probability of offending someone that's been in the Catholic background. On the one hand, it's also caused many people to discover the reality of Jesus Christ, despite all the other trappings of administration. Dave is so fixated on that aspect of it that he does not regard literal Babylon on the banks of Euphrates as being relevant in future prophecy. So that's a place where he and I, are, although we're good friends, have an agreement to disagree agreeably. In fact, at the pre-trib study group, when Dave presented his papers that made up his book, I was asked to be the rebuttal presentation. And everybody expected me, because they knew my mentality in terms of expecting literal Babylon on the Euphrates to be relevant. I'll come back to that in a minute. See, chapter 18 of the book of Revelation describes Babylon the Great. Some scholars feel that there are two different things in view here. That chapter 17 deals with mystery Babylon, the religious side of it. And chapter 18 is Babylon the Great, a city. And the people that are upset when the city is destroyed are three groups of people: kings, merchants, and those that trade by sea. Each one of these groups is singled out almost like a poem as bemoaning from a great distance that Babylon fell in 1 hour. Kings, merchants, and those that trade by sea. Now, it would seem that, if nothing else, the Holy Spirit's giving us a clue that the basis of this emergence was world trade. Kings, merchants, and those that trade by sea. But I don't see any reason to separate these two. The chapter divisions are man's invention. Now, you'll define that most scholars will fall into one of two camps. They'll either embrace Dave Hunt's excellent presentation, well-documented presentation on the Vatican aspect of this. Others dismiss that and focus on Babylon as a literal city, and many of them feel it's maybe just idiomatic of New York or something like that. I don't believe that. I think that Scripture is very means what it says and says what it means. But one of the things that I was facing when I had to be the rebuttal presenter to Dave Hunt on the great whore aspect, the woman rides the beast aspect, is I said both are true, and that shocked everybody. I believe Dave Hunt is right on the mark with what he's saying in his book, A Woman Rides the Beast. I think it's an essential book for any serious Christian. But I also disagree with Dave. I believe Babylon is destined from the Scripture to reemerge as a major centroid on the planet Earth. And this aspect of the Assyrian aspect of the Antichrist underscores that to me even more so. But let me show you where I think the answer is. By the way, the book of Revelation can be portrayed as a book about two women. The first woman is the woman of chapter 12, which you can call Israel if you visualize Israel as starting at Genesis chapter 3. And the first woman is in heaven, portrayed in heaven. She's the mother of a man-child. She's clothed with the sun. Her identity is tied up with the sun, moon, and stars, which is a link to Genesis 38. Her enemy is the dragon. Her relationship, she's hated by the world. She's sustained by the wings of heaven. She has headdress as a crown of 12 stars. Her status is widowed and divorced. And by the way, those are idioms from the Old Testament about Israel. Read the book of Hosea. Her final location is New Jerusalem. In contrast to her, the other woman is the woman of chapter 17, the woman that rides the beast. Where is she? Upon many waters. She's the mother of, not of the man-child, of the harlots. She's not clothed with the sun, she's clothed with purple, scarlet, and gold. Her identity is she reigns over the kings of the earth. Her enemy are the ten kings. She's riding the beast, but ultimately that beast turns and consumes her, interestingly enough. She's caressed by the world rather than hated by the world. She's sustained by the dragon as long as he lasts. Her headdress has the mystery of Babylon the Great engraved on it. She makes a strange boast. She says, I am no widow. She's putting herself in Revelation in contrast to the woman of chapter 12. Interesting. And her final location, of course, is the habitation of demons. But there's another comparison that I encourage you to do on your own. People often ask me, how can I get through this enigma about Babylon? And I suggest very simply, read three pairs of chapters. Read Isaiah 13 and 14. Read Jeremiah 50 and 51. And read Revelation 17 and 18. Those are three pairs. Isaiah 13 and 14, Jeremiah 50 and 51, and Revelation 17 and 18. What I suggest you do is read those six chapters at one sitting. Take you less than an hour. What you'll discover by reading the passages is the consistent use of phrases among all three authors, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and John. You'll find many nations attacking. This is not one attack, many nations. This isn't an attack against Babylon by the Persians or something. This is many nations attacking. You'll find that in Isaiah 13 and 14, 15 and 51, and also in Revelation 16, verse 16 of chapter 17. You'll also discover that in the passages, Israel is in the land and forgiven. That means that that eliminates most of history. Couldn't have happened in the past. In Isaiah 13, verse 19, and Jeremiah 50, verse 40, it says it's going to be destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. The same expression is used by both of them. That's also implied by the Revelation page in Revelation 18. In both Isaiah and Jeremiah emphasize, again and again and again, it's never to be inhabited, the bricks will never be reused. Especially in Jeremiah, it goes on and on about that. It's also clear that the event we're talking about occurs during what's called the Day of the Lord. That makes it, if you will, an eschatological event near the end times. Isaiah emphasized that, Jeremiah emphasized that, and Revelation, of course, underscores that. Both Isaiah and Jeremiah underscore that we're talking about a literal pride of the Chaldeans' excellency, a literal Chaldean city on the banks of the Euphrates. This is not an idiom or a rhetorical device. It's interesting that Jeremiah and Revelation also emphasize that kings fornicate with her and they're drunk with wine. In fact, even both Jeremiah and Revelation uses the expression of scarlet, purple, a golden cup in her hand, and so forth. You'll find that when you read all six of these chapters, you'll have the feeling, you'll sense the common articulation, despite the difference in authors and the different times that they wrote. Now, how do you reconcile this? How can I say that both things are true? The way I do that is by looking at Zechariah 5. You know, the book of Zechariah is studded with little enigmatic prophecies. Some of them are quite clear and some of them are real riddles. But in Zechariah chapter 5, Zechariah encounters a vision. This isn't a literal thing, it's a vision thing. The woman in the ephod. Let's take a look at what happens in Zechariah 5, starting at verse 5. Then the angel that talked with me went forth and said unto me, lift up now thine eyes and see, what is this that goeth forth? And by the way, small point perhaps, but if you look through your Bible, when it says, lift up thine eyes, that's almost like a code phrase, that something very important is coming. When you go through the Torah, the Old Testament, Abraham lifted up his eyes. What follows is not just another thing, it's something very significant. It's a way of emphasis. And that's what's happening here with this angel that's talking to Zechariah. Lift up now thine eyes, and see what is this that goeth forth. And I said, what is it? And he said, this is an ephah that goeth forth. Now, an ephah is a large volumetric measure. It was the standard commercial measure, like we might use the word bushel. It was a commercial, it was the standard commercial measure in volume. A talent was the standard commercial measure of weight. So one is volume, one is weight in their parlance. He said, what, this is an ephah that goeth forth. And he said, moreover, this is their resemblance through all the earth. So this isn't isolated, it's something broader in concept. And behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead. And this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephah. So again, you got this big, visualize it like a huge jar. There is a woman put in the jar, and the lead is going to seal her in there. The lead lid is going to plug the hole. The woman has a name. We'll find out who she is. He said, this is wickedness. So this woman personifies wickedness. It's my presumption that this woman is somehow equivalent to the mother of harlots of Revelation 18. He said, this is wickedness. And he cast it, the woman, into the midst of the ephah and cast the weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. So this woman is sealed in this container. She can't get out. Then Zechariah says, then I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, there came out two women, and the wind was in their wings. For they had wings like the wings of a stork. And they lifted up the ephah between the earth and heaven. Bear in mind, this is a vision. Well, you have to think Jewish. Zechariah is Jewish. The angel is talking to him in his terms. A stork is an unclean bird. It's one of the prohibited creatures. So Zechariah says, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and there came out two women, and the wind was in their wings, and they had wings like the wings of a stork. So this thing, the idioms are being used here are unclean. And what they've got contained in this container is wickedness. And they're picking it up between the earth and heaven. They're going to take it somewhere. What's going on? Then I said out to the angel that talked with me, whither do these bear the ephah? Where are they going with this thing? Notice the last verse. He said to me, to build it a house in the land of Shinar, or Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. The term Shinar occurs seven times in the Old Testament. It is the plain of Shinar is where Babylon stood. If Babylon's the city, Shinar's the county, so to speak. It's always used as a synonym of sorts of Babylon. So what we have pictured here, apparently, in vision, is wickedness is sealed up in this container and is taken back to where it started. To build a house in the land of Shinar should be established and set there upon her own base. That's all. It doesn't explain. That's it. It's an enigma. But when you stand back from the whole picture and you understand Babel from Genesis 11 and Nimrod, the rebel, and you understand that he was the first world dictator, you also understand that all idolatry, false worship, was codified in Babylon. And always has since. It is the fountainhead of all forms of false ideas. Even the zodiac that we use in astronomy as a geographical reference. Before chapter 11 had Hebrew names and described the glory of God. In chapter 11 on, it's corrupted to the way we have it today. You can track, and that's what the scholars have done, guys like Alexander Hislop and others, you'll track every false concept has its origin in Babylon. Now, when Babylon was powerful, those ideas were, of course, permeated through their empire. When they're conquered by the Persians, that priesthood always follows the money. They migrated to the centroid of the Persian Empire. When the Persians are conquered by the Greeks, it goes there. When the Greeks are conquered by Rome, where does that priesthood go to? To Rome. If you study pagan Rome, before Constantine, all that, you'll discover that everything they're doing, all the ideas, all the strange stuff they do, are repackaging in Latin what used to be done in Chaldean in Babylon. New names, same gods. And Ashtoreth is Astarte, and you can track, you can find tables in your commentaries that will give you the Chaldean name, the Greek name, the Latin name, and so forth. Now, same ideas. What I personally conjecture from this, that we're seeing here, is that this evil system, which of course permeated the Vatican when Constantine legalized Christianity, and his the third successor after him, after the apostate, and then anyway, when you get to Theodosius, he made Christianity the state religion of Rome, and he outlawed the others. That was the biggest catastrophe of the Christian church, because suddenly it became politically correct to be a Christian. Regeneration, this Holy Spirit had nothing to do with it. It was a question of joining the club. And what starts to happen is they start repackaging all their traditions, pagan traditions, into Christian garments. That's where you get the, you can track most of, I should be careful about the kind of statement, but most of our traditions that are not justified in Scripture come from Babylon originally. The Christmas tree. Look at Jeremiah 10 sometime. The wassail bowl, mistletoe, all those ideas are from Babylon. It's astonishing to discover, not just the names of our days of the week and so on, it's amazing how it pervades our whole culture. And I think you can get carried away with spook shows, worrying too much about it, just recognize that we're not of this world, we're of the Lord. But what I personally see the Scripture saying is that this whole system is going to return to where it started to get its final judgment. I think that's true of Babylon. I think the power centroid somehow is going to migrate back to where it started. And that's why, as I begin to realize that there's a high likelihood that this, the Antichrist as we call him, this world, I don't like that term Antichrist. I can't get away from it because it's so common usage, but the term Antichrist is used by John in a different sense twice in his epistles. The spirit of Antichrist. John, who wrote those epistles, was the penman of the book of Revelation, never used it in the book of Revelation. The spirit of the Antichrist obviously is evil, don't misunderstand me. But I think it's an inappropriate label, really, for this coming world leader that has 46 other labels in the Scripture. And that's why I feel free to call him Nimrod II, just to confuse people, see? I think the final world dictator is going to be an echo, in some sense, of the first world dictator. And I think his capital will be Babylon, and it's going to receive judgment. And I say, Chuck, gee, where do you get all this? I don't see anything on the horizon. Good! You can't accuse me of trying to shape my theology by reading the daily paper. Because there's no evidence of what I'm saying is correct. But that's what we call the null hypothesis. You see, if you start to see next month, next year, 5 years, who knows when, some things start to happen to bring Babylon to more world prominence. If you start to see a global organization start to echo East and West, with the East starting to be primary, remember you heard it here first. Huh? But more seriously, the fact that it isn't evident in our current publications frees me from any accusation of what they call eisegesis, not exegesis. Trying to read into the text things that are happening. No, it's the other way around. Let's hear what the text says and understand it and then watch. You follow me? That's my suggestion. And so, now, so we have the woman called Wickedness, sealed the town of lead, carried by two women with wings of a stork, that's important, between earth and heaven, to build it a house in the land of Shinar where it shall be established and set there upon her own base. In other words, where she belonged in the first place. And so, now, there's a couple of other things. Let's just, before we close, take a look at another verse. Again, Revelation 17:11 says, "And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition." I do believe that that verse fits the structure I showed you in that complicated diagram earlier in the presentation. But it doesn't mean it's limited to that. One of the things that's true of Scripture, in fact, one of its fascinating challenges, often a thing is described to have multiple meanings. It's true in one sense, but it's also true in a different sense. And We think of Jesus as the Nazarene, because he was raised in Nazareth. He's also the netzer, the branch. There's a pun involved. The Holy Spirit deals in puns. This verse may have some other significance. The beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, but he's of the seven. There are people that believe that what may be operative here, in myth form, is reincarnation. One of the fascinating aspects of that belief, reincarnation, I suppose you heard about the guy that wrote out his will who believed in reincarnation. He left everything to himself, you know. Reincarnation is clearly non-biblical. Let's not get confused about that. The scripture says, is appointed unto man but once the judgment. And but once to die and after this the judgment. In other words, that reincarnation is not, in fact, that phrase in the book of Hebrews is there for that reason, as a rebuttal to reincarnation. It's not there to indicate a guy can only die once. Because there are several people that died twice. Lazarus died twice. Widow of Nain's son died twice. There are others. But that's not what we're talking about. That's not why it's there. It's there to rebut the concept of reincarnation. It's amazing how that idea pervades many, many, almost all pagan belief systems. Do you know why? It's a rebuttal to Satan's lie in the garden. You shall not surely die. Satan hates the resurrection. And his rebuttal of that is to sell this idea of reincarnation. How does he sell it? By demonic episodes. Should you ever encounter a long-dead relative that tells you things that only your great-grandfather or your grandfather could know, don't be impressed, because you know it's non-biblical. How on earth is that pulled off? By a demon spirit. They have memories that go back generations. They're in a position to counterfeit these kind of experiences. You need to cling to the Word of God and understand that reincarnation is Satan's lie. Now, the beast that's coming is obviously a demonic personage. So he could pull off the appearance that he's the reincarnation of Tilgath-Pileser or Sargon or one of these Assyrian leaders or whoever, or John F. Kennedy or whatever. He could pull it off. Why? Because they have the information that you don't, nor few people would have. So that's a possibility that this is, here's the beast that was and is not, even he's the eighth, but he's of the seven. In other words, somehow he may be posing as literally one of the great previous leaders. How would he do that? By really reincarnating? Of course not, no. But he could simulate it. He could create the impression. So that's a possibility. There's another one that's even more closer to home. Could he be a clone? Is it possible that this future leader is somehow a clone of some great past leader somehow? The technology has been detailed for you in Jurassic Park. All you need to do to recreate a creature is a piece of DNA, and maybe a little bit more. So that's a possibility. There's a huge debate among theologians. Can a clone be saved? The theologians are going to chew on that one a long time. You can think of a lot of reasons why they couldn't be, and yet that's also dangerous ground. I wouldn't put anything beyond the reach of God. At the same time, a clone is a man-made thing. There is a theology that says there'd be nothing man-made in heaven except scars. His wrists and his feet. There's another possibility. It's sort of a mix of all of these. Is he a Nephilim? Is he somehow the result of mischief by fallen angels? And I would not put any technology out of reach of a fallen angel. We've learned that from the Nephilim of Genesis 6 and the Rephaim all through the Old Testament, the walking dead. Why do I tend to suspect that a clone can't be saved? Because a Rephaim cannot rise. The Rephaim in the book of Isaiah points out the Rephaim are not eligible for resurrection. So you need to understand that. So from all that, that doesn't mean I'm right. That's just a tentative conclusion, but we're all learning. One of the things, a lot of people are shocked by my presentation because we've published a lot of materials that echo the traditional view that the Antichrist is out of Western Europe. And some people say, gee, it's kind of gutsy for it to come up and say, gee, maybe that's wrong, maybe this is a better view. Listen, the day that we stop learning, we're in trouble. The day that we hold back from you some discovery that we've made that may obsolete some previous things we've said, the day we hide that, we're no longer being faithful. So I'm not to the point where I want to oversell this particular viewpoint. And yet I do want to present it to you as a possibility, primarily for the purpose of encouraging you to study. I'm going to put a challenge on the screen, and if you accept this challenge, you flunk the course. This is not a time to close ranks with me. This is a time to stand up and challenge what I'm putting on the table. It's a challenge as follows. I believe we are being plunged into a period of time about which the Bible says more than it does about any other period of time in history, including the time that Jesus walked the shores of Galilee or climbed the mountains of Judea. That is obviously a preposterous statement, that the Bible says more about the time we're moving into than it does about the whole gospel period. How do you challenge that audacious expression? You have to do two things. First of all, you've got to find out what the Bible says about these days. And the second thing you've got to do is find out what's really going on. Now, a few years ago, that was a tough assignment. The Bible part's easy because you just read and dig in and find out. How do you find out what's really going on? You can't buy the 10 o'clock news. We live in a society in which the mainline media takes pride in its ability to foist its own agenda, to shape opinion rather than inform it. And the scandals are manifold. But the good news is there's an end run on the mainline media. It's called the Internet. It's called talk radio. It's called over 1,000 proprietary newsletters in various professional fields that are self-sponsored, that have their only claim to survival is their integrity. In every field, in every industry, there are dominant newsletters that let you know what's going on. And in the geopolitical arena, too, in the military arena, they are. You can find these things out. And with the Internet, it's easy. If you know how, you can find out anything on the Internet. You can find out which Russian shipbuilding programs are behind schedule. You can find out the layout of your neighbor's house, if you know how. You can make a list of most crazy things. You can find out anything if you know how. The Internet is open, exciting. So you can find out what's going on. Now, we monitor 10 strategic trends on our website. And there's no more passwording. It's free. You can just check in. Weapons of mass destruction, the rise of Islam. Each one of these is a category of intelligence gathering in the secular world. It also is biblically relevant. The struggle for Jerusalem, the Magog invasion, the rise of the European superstate, the rise of China, biotech and global pestilence, the rise to ecumenical religion throughout the world, the tide towards global government, and the unique challenges to America. Each one of these is a trend that we try to monitor several ways. We keep you up to date on our website. But if you log on our website, there's a place you can sign up for a weekly newsletter that's free. Once a week, by email, you'll get a little one-page summary, what happened this week that's biblically relevant, and the websites that are following it competently. Free. All we need is your email address. If you get tired of it, you turn it off whenever you like, but there's no charge. It's just part of our outreach to you. And now, there are paths to our ultimate venture. Most of you are aware, of course, that our book is now out by Thomas Nelson, Learn the Bible in 24 Hours. But if you want a more comprehensive approach to that, we have an audiovisual presentation on CD-ROM that has 1,400 computer-animated diagrams from Genesis to Revelation. It's gotten endorsements from Tim LaHaye, Hal Lindsey, Tommy Ice, Marlon Maddox, Ed Heinsohn, most of the conservative scholars have applauded it. Joe Farah, the founder and CEO of World Net Daily, the primary internet newspaper, has endorsed it. He and his wife use it for their studies. If you have survived that ordeal, then we encourage you to take the Bible verse by verse, book by book. And we have our traditional cassette tapes plus notebooks with all the notes and diagrams, but they're much more affordable now on CD-ROM. The audio is an MP3, so you can download to your players. It has all the texts and stuff, and also most of them are starting to have PowerPoint slides and so forth. And we also publish topical briefings. Most of you are aware of the fact that we have probably closer to 100 now briefing packages on various topics, archaeological, scientific, doctrinal, what have you. But we also are getting into videos, and they're also very popular. If for no other reason, you can pass it on to a neighbor as a loaner and so forth. Other resources, we do publish a monthly news journal, and if you call us and give us your address, we'll give you a year subscription without charge as our way of getting acquainted, in the hopes, of course, that you find it useful enough to continue. Our internet site is khouse.org. People can't pronounce Koinonia House, let alone spell it. Everyone calls us khouse. khouse.org is the internet site. We monitor the strategic trends, and they're free. They're no longer passworded. The e-news I've just told you about, the weekly bulletins. We also are host to the Blue Letter Bible, which you have the entire Bible in English, Hebrew, and Greek, all word searchable. Commentaries, dictionaries, encyclopedias, all word searchable, and all free. Underline that, free. But our primary interest is to encourage you to get into or start, if you can't find one, the home Bible study. That's where the real growth takes place. That's where the Spirit is free to really move. And to help you do some of that on your own or in a group, is we have a thing called K-Rations, a tape a week subscription program. Each 1 hour tape has a 10-minute little update in the front of it, which obviously loses its timeliness as the years go by. People still collect them for their commentary values, but you have a 10-minute update on the current geopolitical, scientific, or archaeological events that are biblically relevant. Then there's at least about a 1 hour, verse-by-verse, expositional study, chapter-by-chapter, of some book in the Bible. And with it, we also send along study notes, discussion questions, detailed references, diagrams, all that sort of stuff. And they traditionally package these things in the heirloom edition leather-bound albums, and actually imitation leather-bound albums. It just didn't fit on this line. So you can collect them to match the ones you may already have. And by the way, we also have made arrangements to get university course credit for the commentaries, for those of you that want to accumulate credits towards an accredited degree. So that's, now we've talked a lot about pretty dark stuff. And I have a way that I like to close on something like this, because we've been talking about Antichrist and demons and all this dark stuff. And we talked about the coming leader, world leader. And I don't want us to close on that topic. I want us to close on the real coming king. And indulge me this, if you may. You and I are looking for a racial king, king of the Jews. He's a national king. That shocks many people. Yes, he's the king of Israel. It's tragic that most churches fail to understand both of these issues. But he's also king of all the ages, king of heaven, king of glory, king of kings, and lord of lords. And the question today is not really about the Antichrist. Who cares? The real question is, do you know our coming king? Do you really know him? He was a prophet before Moses. He was a priest after Melchizedek, a champion like Joshua, an offering in the place of Isaac, a king from the line of David, a wise counselor above Solomon, a beloved, rejected, exalted son like Joseph, and yet he was far more. The heavens declare his glory. The firmament shows his handiwork. He who is, who was, and always will be. The first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, the Aleph and the Tau, the A and the Z. He was the first fruits of them that slept. He's the Ego I Me, the Ichyach Asher Ichyach, the I Am that I Am. Yes, he's the voice of the burning bush. He was the captain of the Lord's host. He was the conqueror of Jericho. He's enduringly strong, entirely sincere, eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful, imperially powerful, impartially merciful. In him dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily, the very God of very God. He's our kinsman redeemer, but he's also our avenger of blood. He's our city of refuge. He's our performing high priest, our personal prophet, our reigning king. He's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of theology. He's the supreme problem in higher criticism. He's the miracle of the ages. He's the superlative of everything good. You and I are the beneficiaries of a love letter. A love letter that was written in blood on a wooden cross that was erected in Judea some 2,000 years ago. They say he was crucified on a cross of wood, yet he made the hill on which it stood. By him were all things made that were made. Without him was not anything made that was made. And by him are all things held together. Question. What held him to that cross? Let me tell you, it wasn't the nails. You see, at any time he could have said, enough already, I'm out of here. What held him to that cross is love for you and me. He was born of a woman so that you and I could be born again. He humbled himself so that we could be lifted up. He became a servant so that we could be joint heirs with him. He suffered rejection so that we could become his friends. He denied himself so that we could freely receive all things. He gave himself so that he could bless us in every way. He's available to the tempted and tried. He blesses the young. He cleanses the lepers. He defends the feeble. He delivers the captives. He discharges the debtors. He forgives the sinners. He franchises the meek. He guards the besieged. He heals the sick. He provides strength to the weak. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. He serves the unfortunate. He sympathizes and he saves. His offices are manifold. His reign is righteous. His promises are sure. His goodness is limitless. His light is matchless. His grace is sufficient. His love never changes. His mercy is everlasting. His word is enough. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's irresistible. He's invincible. The heaven of heavens cannot contain him. Man cannot explain him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but soon learned they couldn't stop him. The personal representative of the ruler of the world couldn't find fault with him. The witnesses couldn't agree against him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him. The grave couldn't hold him. He always has been and always will be. He had no predecessor and he'll have no successor. You can't impeach him and he ain't going to resign. His name is above every name, that at the name of Yeshua, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. His is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you all.